Welcome to this episode of Eureka. We have a guest, Professor Rajiv Lakshman Karandikar.
Dr. Rajiva Lakshman Karandikar is a distinguished statistician and sophologist. He has been heading the Chennai Mathematical Institute since 2010. Born in 1956, Dr. Karandikar is a well-known mathematician. After completing his BSc from Indore University, he pursued his MStat and PhD from Indian Statistical Institute in Calcutta. After completing postdoctoral research from the University of North Carolina, Dr. Karandikar served as professor in a few eminent universities. His area of interest is probability theory and stochastic processes, application of statistics, cryptography. Among the various awards conferred on him, the noted ones are the Young Scientist Medal in 1985, the S.S. Bhatnagar Prize in 1999.
Thank you for joining us.
Most welcome.
From Chennai Mathematical Institute, you're the director of this institute, and we are happy to have you in this program.
I'm happy to be on the program.
You know, most students,
at
least when they go to their higher classes, when they cross their high school, they have some kind of a maths phobia. They think that maths is not their cup of tea and they can't do it. You know, they think the maths teachers are some kind of a special breed, you know, made somewhere, maybe not in this earth, but somewhere else. But how did you get passionate about maths? Is it just you stumbled here or is it something
that... No, it's much more than that. My dad was a mathematics professor.
Okay.
And my mother was chemistry professor. Now the question can be why I chose maths or chemistry.
Yeah.
But that's besides the thing. But yeah, so I grew up with mathematics around me. My father, mathematician and statistician also.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm.
So, in our day-to-day conversations or in my childhood, he never sat with me with a school book and taught me.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
But the mathematics teaching was like, you know, without any paper pencil, just in talk. And it was in an interesting way. You see, one of the problems, why math phobia develops, I have to think a lot about it, is because it is taught in such a drab way.
Mm-hmm.
These children, as they are taught, they don't relate to what is happening. Okay? So I'll give you a simple example, which I use with my son, and it is, I would say, good success. So for example, we know train reservations.
Yeah.
You buy a ticket. These days, you get L or B written along with the number.
Okay.
But if you go back in time, in our times, we used to just get a card ticket with your birth number will be there, but you don't know.
Birth number 16.
So now, given the birth number and given the which class you are traveling, there's a simple formula by which you can decode, is it upper, lower, etc., etc. Now, this is a very interesting problem, and it's enough to teach this children. Okay.
It's something that you can do, by just calculating. Okay, if it is a third class, first, second, third, four, five, six, seven,
it's
eight.
It's a logical thinking.
Yeah.
But if one comes down to that, mathematics is all about teaching
finding
logical
the pattern.
Thinking.
Uh-huh.
Finding patterns and logical thinking. Okay. Building this analytical capability is what I call mathematics, not teaching this theorem or this result or that result.
Or boringly solving 100 problems one after another.
So if we make children understand, present to them such interesting things which they can relate to, and then, this I have seen with my son. I mean, we tell him this and then others say, are you sure? And he'll say yes. And then when we go to the train, of course he's right. And, that gives pleasure.
Yeah, pleasure, okay.
Because, these grown-ups couldn't figure out and I could figure out.
Okay.
So it's math phobia is developing because they don't relate to mathematics, to the world around them. On top of that, the teacher is a tough teacher in school and at home. By the time they come to class two, dad declares that, if you have other problems, I can help you, but don't ask me math questions. Now, that is a very damaging thing to happen. Because that already gives a signal to the son that if my dad couldn't do it, what can I do?
Because for most people, the dad is kind of the
superhero.
Superman. Should be knowing everything. Yeah.
At that age. The son grows up later, but at that age.
We all know that.
Yeah.
It's fine.
At that age, it is like that. So I think this negative reinforcement at home, coupled with what they hear around in the society, these two together is the damaging part.
You talked about something that you did with your son.
Yeah.
But do you remember something that happened with your dad or maybe with your school teacher, which sort of inspired you to look at maths more deeply than the just let me pass it on or maybe get the full mark. You know, beyond that, look at maths.
It was never about marks. With me also, when my dad taught me, it was never about marks. It was teaching something logically and getting to the core of it. And then, if I do it, it's like this, you know, the kids always would like to do something which others be amazed at.
No.
So, it's that. So, he taught me, let's say, addition with carryover.
Okay.
Okay. Or subtraction with carryover. Okay. And he taught me why it happens. And it can be taught in many interesting ways. Okay, you know, you different colored balls and one red ball equal to 10 black balls, etc., etc. But it is one thing to give example on the board and it is another thing to actually have such objects and use them.
In young age, actually concrete objects.
So, you know, you put a red ball and draw 10 black balls and now out of this you give so much. So, now you are relating to it rather than some numbers being written on the board. Okay, so this is something which is concrete and this is something which my dad did. It was not balls, it was some other objects. Colored objects. As we are talking, I remembered it was not balls, but it was these buttons.
Okay.
Different colored buttons. Because balls, 100 balls storing somewhere is a problem. But these buttons, you can sit with it in one place and play with them.
Good. I think perhaps even some teachers who are watching this program should try this kind of stuff in their primary school.
Yes.
And teach children mathematics with concrete objects.
Or interest, it grows in primary.
Primary.
Later, it gets reinforced. Some people who are interested may be turned off. But it is very difficult for someone who is turned off at primary to actually make him interested later. So,
from your childhood, where were you growing up? I mean, it's not obviously Chennai, right?
It was Indore.
Indore. What was the kind of ambience there? I mean, what kind of place were you growing up? I mean, what kind of school you went? I mean, anything that sticks to your mind from your childhood?
We had a lot of free time.
Interesting. Okay.
Ambience, etc. is all there, but I mean, the first thing which strikes me is we had enough free time. We had homework, of course, but I've seen my son and I've seen other kids and so on struggling. They have no time left in a day for them. So, I think just having free time is the most important thing which in later generation kids are missing.
So, they are not able to actually explore what they want. I mean, they are not able to actually think.
What are the possibilities? What you would like to do? What others are doing? This, that, that they are unable to do. So, the first thing which occurred to me, which is different in modern generation, is free time.
We have to have some free time. Yes, maybe it's a good point to have a small break. Maybe you can also have a small free time before we continue with our program. A short break and don't go back. We'll come back again. Welcome back to this episode of Eureka. We are with her, Professor Rajiv, a mathematician from Chennai Mathematical Institute. So, we were talking about your childhood, how you had some free time, how your father used to inspire you with, practical mathematics. So, you started thinking mathematics as something to think about rather than merely, drill of doing exams. Let's come back to your modern times, your research.
Okay.
I find in your CV that you did some work for CBI.
Yes.
Maths and CBI.
Yes, maths is everywhere. So, let me talk about what I was doing with CBI and mathematics.
CBI is actually Criminal Bureau of Investigation.
Absolutely.
I'm correct, no? Not,
yes. Not some other acronym, no.
Yeah, okay. Please.
So, this was when I was in Delhi at Indian Statistical Institute. I was the head of the center. And one day walks in a CBI inspector.
Okay.
So, the CBI inspector, when he walked in, he asked me, have you heard about this story? I said, yes, what is there in the newspaper? I have heard it's in the front page. I live in Delhi, in front page. So, he says, what do you think about it? I said, about what? Do you think that having identical marks for 7 students, getting identical marks in physics, chemistry and mathematics, does it raise questions? So, I said, to be honest, yes, it does surprise me. It does raise a question. But it's not enough to even raise a suspicion that they have cheated.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay. However, if you give me the entire data set, that is all the 180 all the 100,000 students.
All the students who wrote the exam.
All the students who wrote the exams and their answers on each question, A, B, C, D, O. O for omission.
Omission. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then what were the correct, what is wrong? When you give me this is tons of data and at the moment, I don't know, but looking at the data, I can see patterns, and from there I can say either that there is no reason to make raise questions, or I'll tell you why there is a reason to raise questions. He said, oh, sorry, privacy things, I can't give you this data. I said, then sorry, I can't analyze. But the story doesn't
tell you. Mathematician is a mathematician, but not a magician.
No. Good. If the data doesn't tell me, I can't.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
I can't force an answer out of the data. So we departed. I thought nothing can be. Next day he came again. He says, well, I can't give you that, but these people who are in question, I can give you their 180 answers. Mm-hmm. I said, okay, there's a starting
at
point.
Least, okay. Yeah.
And then there's the Eureka moment, because as soon as we see, they were identical on each question. It is not just that the physics and chemistry and maths answers were total, were right, wrong, were correct. They had omitted exactly the same questions. They had answered exactly the same right questions. And even when they were wrong,
they are exactly wrong.
Exactly the same wrong option they had chosen.
Okay. Uh-huh. Okay. Uh-huh. Same wrong option.
Same wrong option.
So, which means there are three wrong options.
And they have picked the same
they
wrong.
They all picked up. Okay. Uh-huh.
And now, if imagine a situation where, you know, all of them had scored only one wrong answer.
Okay.
Then again, it is inconclusive, because, you know, right answer, you both can be geniuses and you are picked
you
right answer.
Yeah.
That's not information.
Why I know the right answer can't be a question. Okay.
But there were enough wrong answers. And those wrong answers were also identical. And omission numbers were also identical. What question A did not answer, the same question B also. And so 10 of them. And this is conclusive evidence, statistically.
Statistically.
So now, by that, what do we mean? It has to be presented to a court of law. And I was told that unlike in the books that I read, which are based in US or UK and so on and so forth, at least US, where the expert goes and testifies in court, that doesn't happen in India. So I was told that he will ask me questions like you are asking me questions.
Okay.
I will give answers. They will be transcribed. And this will be presented to the court. I will not be called.
You will not be called to the court. Mm-hmm.
So the best way to do then was to create a mathematical or statistical model. And then under reasonable, I can explain that, but we don't have enough time.
Yeah.
But under that, we compute the probabilities. Now, if I tell you that probability is 0.23 into 10 to the power minus 20, nobody can make head or tail out of that. But if I tell you that probability is much smaller than DNA matching of two people, and therefore, if DNA matching is evidence that X was present at the crime scene, then this is evidence that
there is a computer. Okay.
So the final answer has to be something in the sense to which the judge can
relate. Judge can understand.
If it is 0.23
it's
into 10 to
not
power
only judge,
minus
I suppose the whole
use.
Open court should be able
open
to understand.
Open court, in particular the judge, and then by and large people should be able to relate. Mm-hmm. There will be people who say, oh, DNA matching is no evidence. Then okay, then this is also no evidence. I'll grant.
Okay.
So that is the thing, to be able to communicate the answer.
So you kind of help the CBA to, nail the issue.
Yeah.
Very interesting. Another thing that I saw in your CV.
Yes.
Something that sort of strike my mind is something called white noise.
Yes.
White noise. It's something like, you know, tall red. It appears as if,
what has the color got to do with noise?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I mean.
So without going into why that is called white noise, I'll try to explain what this whole thing is
about.
What
is this called white noise? Yes.
What is this object called white noise and why is it relevant, etc., etc.? And we are doing this on television. People will be watching me on television. So it
yes,
is very
of course.
Interesting.
Uh-huh. It's related to television.
It's related to television.
Okay,
also.
Please. Uh-huh.
One of the relations. There are many other
many
things.
Many other. Okay.
So, you know, these days we watch on smart TVs. When the signal goes off, it just gives you a blue screen.
Okay.
But if you are sometime somewhere in a mall or in a railway station or somewhere watched, when the signal goes off, what you see is black and white dots.
Lot of flickers.
Dancing all over, flickering.
You know, the old CCTV camera.
Everything.
Yeah.
So old sets, this will happen. When the signal is off, you are seeing just black and white dots. What is it? So actually, even when there is no signal, it is trying to decode whatever it is receiving and then displaying that. What it means is that even when there
whatever
is...
Whatever it is receiving means, maybe it is not from the television station,
no.
But something somewhere...
See, especially this is a lot more in the terrestrial transmission, not through cable.
Cable, uh-huh.
Terrestrial transmission, the as the waves come to you and your antenna receives the waves, okay? It is there is a signal which has been sent from the television studio or the antenna there. And there is atmospheric interference. Mm. And the atmospheric interference is what we can call noise. And it is present whether there is signal or no signal. Now, when there is no signal, it is only noise. And it tries to interpret that and show you what it is. So it is this black and white dancing dots. But when there is signal, the noise is still present.
Noise is there and the signal is also
there. It is, and what the your TV set receives is a superimposition of these two.
Yeah.
Okay. And there is this theory which is called filtering theory. Okay. This whole thing is communication engineering, but the ideas are statistical. In statistics, we'll call it error, it is called noise. In statistics, we'll call estimate, here it is called filter.
Filter, okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, nonetheless, ideas are same. So, you study and model the noise. What kind of pattern is this noise?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm.
So, individually, you can't say what it is because it is noise, but there is a pattern. And we model that pattern as a white noise. And then we build in algorithms which will filter out the noise and try to get you the signal. It is not always possible. If there is a lot of rain, lot of thing, then you know you get a chirpy signal.
Oh, okay.
What you see is not such a thing. And on a clear day, you see a better signal. Because on a clear day, the interference is less. So there is noise, but it is less and it is within the capabilities of your model and algorithm to decode and to filter out this noise. When the noise increases beyond a limit, then you see it still.
So basically, you are using statistics to create the mythical Annapakshi.
Yes.
Which can separate out water and milk.
Dood ka dood, paani ka paani.
Paani ka paani. And then the statistics helps you to do it.
Yes.
Not some magic wand.
No, there is no magic wand. There is a statistics, there is mathematical model, and then there is implementation of that via an algorithm.
Mathematics is kind of, you know, seem to be around everywhere.
Mathematics
is very, very interesting. Maybe we'll take a very short break here and then come back and continue this discussion. It's getting very interesting. Maths, people think, is boring, fearful. Look at here, I mean, we are having fun. Let's have a short break. Don't go back. We'll come back again. Welcome back to this show. We are with us Professor Rajiv, Director of Chennai Mathematical Institute. We are having a very wonderful conversation, a very interesting conversation of how you got interested in mathematics and what kind of mathematics that you do. You help CBI, you help reduce noise from signal so that we can get better signal. It's very interesting, your work. But for ordinary audience,
yeah.
I mean, whether you're a parent or a student, maths means phobia.
Now, there are many reasons for that. First and foremost, as we were talking about it, it is primary school, okay? If somebody is unable to do a problem, the child has not understood what has been told, the algorithm. When he asks again, he's told the same thing again, okay? And that doesn't help.
Maybe slightly in a louder voice.
Slightly in a louder voice. And third time, in an angrier voice.
Angrier voice, okay.
Okay? So that is a problem, and that early age, kids are very susceptible, and they think that, oh, I'm no good. And once that thought enters, it is very damning.
Wow.
So one thing is to somehow, you know, I don't know, there's no magic recipe for that. But for teachers, if a child has not understood, we have to explain it in a different words. Even if it is the same algorithm, you explain in different words.
Different strategy.
Different strategy, if possible, give an example, if possible, say that, okay, you think about it, talk to your friends, we'll talk about it tomorrow.
Maybe give a
that
time.
Might help.
Give Maybe time. Give a thinking time.
Give time. Let the kid interact with other kids who have understood, okay? Maybe the teacher can't explain in different words, his friends can explain in different words.
Maybe, so, they can talk the language,
yeah.
Lingo.
So different. Somehow we have to get out of the where we are got into, okay? Along with that, the other thing is where at home, dad says, I can't help you, as I said. So these two more relevant and interesting mathematics related to real life, okay? Mathematics related to real life. And generally, parents being more aware that, you know, how they behave or what they say, the student should not be turned off from mathematics.
Yeah, I was also talking to some maths educators about this problem. I mean, they also said that two more things can sort of help. One is concretize things. I mean, at very young age.
Yes.
Don't put very abstract stuff.
Absolutely.
Concretize. Second, they were also saying that think of maths activity.
Yeah.
Maths is not necessarily blackboard and paper. I mean, think of some activity, some interesting challenges, which, the children can explore and enjoy.
Yeah.
It's an important point that you have made. You are the director of Chennai Mathematical Institute, which is also a deemed university.
Yes.
Which essentially means you are also the vice chancellor of this place.
Yes.
Before this, you are with ISI,
yeah.
Where you have also been interacting with students. So in some sense, we can say that you have been a teacher for a very long time.
Absolutely.
What do you think is an important challenge in higher education in India?
There are many, but let's take some. One is the funding issue.
Okay.
We are growing up, or we are living in a society where parents can pay huge sums of fees to send their child to a KG school or to send their son or daughter to a IIT coaching institution. But when the same IIT demands fees, people are upset. And one can understand it because it is what is the expectation set. So if we have grown up in an environment where, you know, the higher education has to be paid for by the government. Now, when they try to change the rules, there is people get upset, right? So, I think this is one issue which needs to be addressed, because government is able to fund IITs, but then the funding to NIT is not at the same level. Then after that NIT, you come to other colleges, their funding is not to the same level. Then you come to science colleges, their funding is even less. And you come to arts colleges, it is even worse, right? So, after all, government is what? Taxpayers' money. There is a limited resources. If you give more to IIT, then our commerce or arts college is getting less. Right? I mean, there is not infinite supply in the finance minister's pocket that he can just dole out. So, as we are growing, as the awareness is increasing, it's one thing to say that, you know, increase more universities, increase more colleges. How will the funding happen? So, for that, we need to address this issue. And somewhere we need to move towards an era where these, if not entirely, but a large chunk of the expense of the institution is paid for in terms of tuition fees by parents if they can afford it, and if not, via a loan by a bank. To begin with, the government, instead of giving money to the institutions, can guarantee this loan, can subsidize the interest. Hopefully, large chunk of people who actually are capable of repaying back in their life will repay. There is no need to assume that everybody is a crook. No, everybody is not a crook.
Yes, certainly not.
Large number of people will pay. Some they will not pay. And banks will not be able to run after them. There is no fine. So that's why government guarantee. Instead of giving subsidy directly, you give this indirectly guarantee to the bank. This will not happen overnight. But this may not be the... I mean, this is just in 2 minutes what I have said.
A lot of details will
have to be worked out. But something like this, people have to start thinking now, maybe implement 2 years down the road when we have thought about all its consequences and move towards this direction.
So higher education finance is one
major issue. Higher education finance is one area where we need
some rethink some out-of-box solution.
Out-of-box solution is needed. That is the only way where we can, you know, we can have large number of centers of excellence. Otherwise, today we have centers of excellence, very well funded, but they are few. It's directly related to funding. I'm not saying that you just give funds and you get a center of excellence, but fund is a primary requirement. It's as a mathematician, I will say it's necessary but not sufficient.
Right. Yeah. Coming to the charge that you have now.
Yeah.
Director of Chennai Mathematical Institute.
Yes.
Maths teaching. People think that, okay, if I study maths, what? Maybe I'll become a school teacher.
Yeah.
Oh, maybe I may become a college teacher. Maybe some of us might discover some theorems like Ramanujam. Is that the option range? Is that the space for mathematicians today?
That was the option range maybe 30 years ago when we were growing up, or when I chose to be a mathematician, that was the option range.
Okay.
But world has changed. Lot. Better or worse, let us not talk about it.
Okay.
But it has
world
changed.
Has changed. Oh.
And the need for math is felt in the much larger segment of society. For one, from the old license quota permit thing, we have an open society. So, for a manufacturer, earlier he could charge whatever he could, whatever he wanted to. Today, if I charge too much, somebody else will set up a shop, which will undercut me. So, there is a need for optimization, cost reduction. And all these are mathematics. You somehow create model for your whole process and then optimize.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So, there is need. Then there is need for marketing, there is need for fine-tuning your trading strategies, your advertising strategies, whatever strategies. All this today has, also in last 10 years, in the growth of computing power, has meant that a solution that I may give, you are actually able to implement. If you go back 20 years, I could have had the solution.
But there is no...
So I give you a mathematical paper. You say, all this is fine, but you tell me, what do? I said, that I don't know. Then you will say, bewakoof hai. Right? But today, we can translate that solution to actually implement it and in real time get an answer.
Basically, because we have a huge computing
power. And cheap. So, what this has brought in today is what is being called analytics or big data.
Analytics and big data.
These are big things, you know. You might have read, everybody has read, maybe 10 or 12 years ago, the Google strategy officer or somebody senior at Google said that the sexiest job in the next decade is going to be that of a data scientist.
Okay.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so, because we are living in this electronic world, all kinds of data is being captured. Your spending pattern, your travel pattern, or when we are carrying a mobile and with a GPS on, it knows exactly
where you are going.
So somebody somewhere can decode your exact movements, right? If you want to hide it, okay, you turn it off. But if you have nothing to hide, you let it track on. So all kinds of data is being generated. Facebook, Twitter, emails being sent, all this. So this data is extreme. I mean, how Google or Facebook is making money? It's over this. This data is power. So to interpret this data, you need mathematics, statistics, or analytics. Basically, logical thinking. What conclusions one can draw from there? That is what, in the end, what mathematics or statistics is about. These are what are observed. What is that? And these are areas where there is need for people. We are far few places which are able to churn out
people with these
skills,
good capacities and
with
skills.
Yeah. Our math teaching has to change.
To meet this new challenge.
New challenge. I'm not saying destroy the old, but create this parallel path.
Parallel path.
Okay. And more institutions have to do it. There are efforts in that direction. We have made some efforts here. There are others who are doing this effort.
So basically, at the end, you are saying that maths is not nerd, but being cool.
Yes.
So good. This is, I think, a very interesting message. Maths, to most of us, is phobia. Or, you know, something to be done by nerdy people. But here is a mathematician, a statistician who says, it's cool. Yeah, I think the world that comes in, the knowledge economy that people are talking about, that is heralding, requires mathematics in very many ways. It has a lot of opportunities. Thank you. Thank you for being with us in this show.
It was a lot of fun.
We enjoyed this
show.
Thank you. Thank you for being here.